Hello and welcome to today's European SharePoint Office 365 and Azure Community webinar. My name is Shane and I'm delighted to be joined by Matthew Bailey, MVP MCT from Noteworthy Technology and Training in the USA, who will be talking to you today about a live introduction to Microsoft Teams. Remember to join in the conversation about today's webinar on Twitter. Our Twitter handle is @EuropeanSP and our hashtag is ESPC18. Don't forget to check out the Resource Center. This is packed with the latest blogs, ebooks, webinars, and how-to videos. Simply visit sharepointeurope.com/resource-center. From the 26th to the 29th of November, join us in Copenhagen for the European SharePoint Office 365 and Azure Conference. Tickets are still available at sharepointeurope.com. After the webinar, we will have a questions and answers session. Type any questions you have for Matthew in the questions window. Some questions will be selected and answered at the end of the presentation. This webinar will be recorded and will be added to the Resource Center, where you will be notified by email when it is available. And now I'm going to pass you over to our webinar presenter, Matthew Bailey. Hello, Matthew.
Hi, Shane. How are you today?
I'm super.
Well, that's good. Well, thank you so much for having me today as your host. We're going to here to talk about Microsoft Teams. I'm assuming you can see my screen.
Yeah, take it away, Matthew.
All right. So I am going to just quickly tell everybody a little bit about myself, and then we're going to jump into today's demo. At the moment, I am considering myself a Microsoft Teams subject matter expert and a SharePoint all-rounder. I'm an independent consultant and Microsoft certified trainer, author, and MVP. Most of my jobs have been pretty varied, so I have a little bit of administration, some development, some training, some end user project management, etc. I've worked with the Microsoft stack from, depending on the product, between 1 to over 11 years. And if I don't have an answer for your question, I will at least make a note of what it was and try to find somebody who can help you with it. My blog is right here at my name, MatthewJBailey.com. I'm also the author of a book last year called The SharePoint Business Analyst Guide, which I'm very proud of because I felt that people needed a little bit of assistance making sure they were creating quality requirements for their SharePoint projects. But separate from that, we are here today to talk about Microsoft Teams, and I'm very happy to announce that just recently my first major publisher book was released with one of my best friends, the lovely Melissa Hubbard. We both co-wrote this book. It's a great resource for end user guidance, instructions, some real world governance and adoption tips from actual Microsoft Teams deployments, and it's on sale now. And a quick note, if the link in the chat, or if you go to my blog and click on the picture of the book, that you can use the coupon code MatthewTeams, and that will save you 20%, but it's only good at that special link that's either found on my website or from what Shane is sharing in the chat box at the moment. So now that we have the promotional things out of the way, let me get into the goods of the webinar today with what we're going to be talking about. And it just so happens that I received an email earlier today from my supervisor, Hugh G. Ordeal, because he's a bit upset with me that I have all of these tasks for a nonprofit that I've promised to commit my time to. And unfortunately, I haven't gotten any of these tasks done yet. So you can see the first thing from this email is that Hugh is very artistic and loves to create picturesque emails as he sends them to people. For our nonprofit, which is purpose is to save the baby seals that are trapped in the garbage patches of the oceans, we have some tasks that we need to have, and apparently they have to be all done by the end of today. So I've got some fundraising tasks. We have to build a website. We have to organize some people that are going to go out in the streets and ask for donations. And then we have to figure out how we're going to market all of this so that we can actually get people interested to raise money. So What I'm thinking is, because we're here to talk about Microsoft Teams, is that the first thing I could probably do is create one so that we can organize this entire project and get all of my tasks done in under 1 hour. So I'm going to come over to my Microsoft Teams client. And the first thing that I'm going to do is I am going to go over to my chat section on my left-hand menu. Now, the chat is basically a thing that we have that is similar to what Skype for Business Online was, and it will it is basically like an instant message tool for Yahoo or Google or something else. And I'm going to send a message to Hugh because I could actually either video call him or voice call him. But since he's upset at the moment, I'm actually going to just send him a text message to let him know that I, or instant message, let him know that I received his email and that I'm going to get going on the tasks that he has assigned to me. I received your email today, and I will get this. We'll get this all done pronto. And then, because I am just a little bit of a sarcastic fellow, I am also going to add an animated GIF to let him know that I have got this all under control. And here we go. So I've now just sent an instant message to Hugh to let him know that I've got his email. I'm going to take care of all this and there's no problems that I need to be aware of. And oh, apparently Hugh has received my instant message because we can see that he's online and he's watching me. So as usual, I've upset the big boss, and I'm probably going to have to make sure I get all these things done pretty quickly. The next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to come over to the Teams icon on my left-hand menu, and I'm going to go down to the bottom, and I'm going to create a new team for today's projects regarding our nonprofit to save the baby seals. I'm going to click Create Team. I'm going to call Seal Rescue Squad, just because you can name your teams anything pretty much except for some unique characters. I think that's applicable to what we're doing. I could add a description. I have different types of teams that I can create. So my privacy options are private if I'm only going to be adding a few people. It could be public if I want anyone in my entire Office 365 tenant to be able to join it at their leisure, or if I want to automatically add everyone in my entire organization or tenant, I could click the last option. However, at this time, that is limited to up to 1,000 users. So for today's purpose, I only need to create a private team. I also have a couple of options of creating a team from a previous template if I'd had one that was already in the same structure that I was going to be reusing, or if I was using Office 365 groups already for collaboration and I wanted to upgrade that group permanently into a Microsoft team, I could do that as well. So we're going to create our team. The next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to add some people. So some of my coworkers, I am definitely going to need to ask for their help to get all of these things done because we don't have much time. So as you can see, just by typing ahead of the people's names, such as Chris Carehart and Patty Protector, which are two of my besties here who help me with all of my nonprofit help and volunteering, their names and their pictures just quickly come up into the box for me to add them. I click on the add box. Now I have the option to either leave them both as members, or I have the option to create another one as an owner. It's always a good practice to have two team owners per team, not incredibly different than your SharePoint site collections of only having one or two owners, as well as far as what a best practice is. We've changed to Chris to be an owner, and I can close this out. And that has sent a notification to them that they have just been added to the team. So now the next thing I'm going to do is we're going to quickly look at this team and see that what it creates is basically kind of a container for many different things. We have a conversations tab, which is different than your instant message chatting, which is more one-on-one or one to a couple people chats or calls. This is everyone in the Teams conversations that you're going to be typing and sharing information and discussions with here. We have a built-in Files tab, and this Files tab actually is a SharePoint site collection on the back end that has exclusively been created for this team. Now, I could open it in SharePoint if I wanted to. However, at the moment, I don't need to do anything too advanced, and I realize it's just there for storing my files. It also comes with a wiki, which is also stored in the SharePoint site collection. Some people like this for some quick notes or frequently asked questions or instructions about what we're going to do with our team. However, a lot of people aren't the greatest fans of it. And since I don't have a use for it today, I'm going to remove it from my team. But this is completely up to you. As you can also see, with our new team, after it's been created, it comes with one general channel. And by me clicking on the ellipsis, the first thing that you're going to notice is I have a few options on each channel. The first one we have is get connectors, which I'll go into later. And then we have get email address. And I am going to click on that because each channel that is created automatically has an email address created by Teams that is associated with it. I'm going to copy and paste it, and I'm going to come over to my email here that Hugh has sent me. And I am going to forward it to our team so that Hugh doesn't have anything else to get mad at me for. Now, it should just take a moment, and it should show up in the channel of our team here, hopefully. While we're waiting, the quick thing I wanted to point out about why this is so great is because, as you know, people at organizations come and go with how long that they're working there or volunteering, and the people usually lose the content in their email boxes when they leave an organization. And then no one else that was involved with the project has any idea what has happened with the goings-on about it or any information that might be pertinent to them. Now, the thing about Teams is it does not remove specific things automatically when someone is removed from your tenant. All of the contributions, whether it's a discussion, an email, or a document that they have contributed to the team will remain in the team even after they have left. And that's one of the reasons this makes Microsoft Teams such an incredibly powerful tool, meaning not loss of data. So now that I have our beautiful email in my channel here, I know that I've got four tasks I need to take care of. So the first thing that I'm going to do is I'm going to create some more channels. And channels over here, as long as you're an owner, you can add channels to a team. And the thing with channels is you can have up to 200 of them per team, but I admit that it kind of becomes messy if you start to create too many. So Microsoft's suggestion for how you organize your channels within your team is that they either be based on function, like job function, they be based on focus. And then I've also added my personal opinion, which is they could be possibly based on an event date, such as if you were having a quarterly meeting and you wanted to create a channel for each date that the meeting was held on. There isn't necessarily a right or wrong answer on how you create your channels, but I do highly suggest you anticipate what the length of your team's life will be, and then think down the road to understand how will this team look in 3 or 6 months, if that's how long you're going to keep it for, so that things don't start to get placed in the wrong channels, or you're not missing a channel you should have had in the first place, because at this time there's no migration tool for Microsoft to move the content around between channels. However, that might be something coming. We're still waiting for confirmation from Microsoft if that's going to happen. I'm going to come back and I'm going to quickly add some channels. So I know the first one I need to do is for fundraising. I have the option to automatically favorite this for the whole team. Now, if I did, what would happen is in the activity feed on the top left corner, everything that I'm doing in this would automatically be pushed into the activity feed of all the people who I have assigned as members and owners to my team. Now, I'm not going to do that today, but it's important to let you know this so that that way not everyone in your team has to come in and everyone has to favorite a channel. You could just do this for them, but I would do it in a selective manner so that not every single channel has been favorited. We can add one for fundraising. I'm going to add another one for our website. I'm going to add another one for these street fundraising. And then I'm going to add our last one for marketing. And we've got our channels created in our team. That was pretty fast. I'm going to go back to the general channel and I am going to reply to this message in the channel conversations, this email that I sent. And I am going to actually do some at callouts. I'm going to specifically call out my coworkers, Chris and Patty, and I'm going to let them know that, hey, you sent me a urgent email letting me know that we have to, I should learn to type a little bit better, folks. We have to finish these tasks by EOD, meaning end of day today. Now, as I send this reply off to them, what's going to happen is, because I've specifically called out Chris and Patty, they have just received a notification in their Teams client and or Teams mobile device, if they happen to have that installed and notifications on. If they were not logged into either one within somewhere between a few to 15 minutes or so, that actually receive an email message that they had been specifically called out. So I would suggest only calling people out by name when it's urgent or very important, because you don't want them to get too many notifications, but it's a great tool when something's important and they really need to take care of it, that they know where to go with that. Now, usually when people have made sure that they have received your message, they acknowledge it by giving it a thumbs up. And you can see that Chris has just let me know he's liked my message that I've posted, copying him on. And that means to me that he has acknowledged that he has received it. So now we've got things rolling here. I've let the boss, big boss, know that I'm on top of these things. I've got my coworkers involved. I've got a mostly empty team, but I've got the structure and the organization of it. Now we can start to get going on these tasks. Now, I normally do this webinar with my co-author and bestie, Melissa Hubbard, but she was not able to be with us today. So I'm going to go over some of the ways I would have communicated with her and my other cohorts in this in my little presentation, but I'm not actually going to completely go through with all of them. I'm going to go over to the left side for the meetings tab, because normally what I'd do is I would set up a meeting for all of us to get on the same page with this project, and that way we could, you know, just talking sometimes can be a little bit faster, which we can do in Teams as well. But I wanted the first thing to do is to point out to you the calendar on the left side of my Teams client. Now, just to clarify some confusion with this, this calendar is basically just pulling in information from your team and from your private mailbox. It is not connected to any other calendars. So you may wonder why there isn't an enormous amount of events that are listed in it. You can see, however, that in my personal calendar that's associated with this ID, that I had an appointment, that I've got a webinar I had to do today. And I'm thinking you guys probably can guess which webinar that is. So then I'd have the option to schedule some meetings. We've got different types of meetings. We've got a private meeting, which would be just inviting specific people. We could do a channel meeting where we actually pick the team and then the specific channel that we're going to post it in, so that everyone who's following that channel would receive a notice and they just see a button to join it. We also have a new preview type of meeting for Microsoft called a new live event. Now, this is really similar to the GoToWebinar client that you're currently watching me on right now. It's basically a live broadcast type of a concept where you can present things to many people, and there's a chat correspondence where they can interact and ask questions. I've personally attended a couple of these from Microsoft, and I have to be honest that in saying, and this is a good thing I'm saying, that I was absolutely blown away by the voice and video quality of the live event preview that they put on. I am very interested in seeing how this particular feature in Microsoft Teams progresses as it hits general availability. So now that I have recapped some of our options on the different ways I could meet with people in Teams, I am going to come back and show you the last way that you can get a hold of people in your team. And that's by coming down to your conversation bar in within a channel. And you see that we've got some icons underneath each one of these. And one of them is Meet Now. So what I would normally do if I had everyone else on my webinar with me here today is that I would create a Meet Now and we would immediately start meeting. I would say discussion. We can add a little topic for it, and you can see myself here on my my computer camera of fundraising tasks. I could start the meeting, and what would happen is I would be sitting here waiting. Hi, everybody. Thanks for joining today. I would be waiting for all of the people in that channel that were who were interested in the meeting and had been notified to join. Or I could also actually intentionally suggest to add people here. And since there's no one else on the call, webinar with me today, I won't go through with this, but they would just start to join and it would become a video conference call where people would be in different boxes along here and it would show all the attendees. So I will let you guys get back to the team screen. You don't have to look at me much longer here. And then we will go over to another way to communicate in Teams, because once again, I still have all these tasks to do and I need to get a hold of the people that are going to help me with the project. If I go over to the left-hand menu again, we have a calls icon. Now, not everyone is going to have this because it's actually an additional plan. It was similar to Skype for Business Online, which, in case I did not reiterate, Microsoft Teams is formally Skype for Business or Skype for Business Online. However, it's also many other components that have been added to it. And I'll go into that if we have time at the end. But what I want to mention is if you were using Skype for Business or Skype for Business Online and you had a calling plan, you're most likely also going to have it in Teams. You need a calling plan and a phone system to both of those to make it work. And what this the phone system does is it allows you to answer, forward, and make calls. And then the calling plan, you have to select similar to as if you had purchased a cell phone and you needed to pick a call plan. I'm not quite sure how it works in Europe, but in America, you have to pick domestic or international. Perhaps it's that way over there as also. And then that's what actually allows you to dial numbers. So if I had Chris on the webinar with me today, I could very easily just actually start to call him, and this would be starting to make a call to him directly from my computer. So now my computer has turned into a phone system. This is just one other great way that you can communicate with people using Microsoft Teams. So now that I mentioned, we had a couple ways to get everybody to communicate with our team members, but they don't happen to be on the call with me today. So I'm going to actually have to start to resort back to my own devices here and figuring out how I'm going to be able to get some of this work done by myself with perhaps just them adding help here and there via the Teams client. So what I'm going to do is the first thing I need to do is get that grant letter written for our fundraising. So I'm thinking my best approach to this is to try to find a previous grant letter somebody's written on one of our other projects, and I'll just copy it, make some changes, and we'll be able to send it off fast. If we come down to the Files tab, what you're going to start to see is another connection to be able to get to your work from the Teams client. And what this does is it shows you your recent files. It shows you files that have been uploaded into Teams. It shows you any files you've downloaded from Teams. But additionally, you can connect external cloud storage accounts to this team to also share files. Now, the OneDrive account that you add is automatically added. This is your OneDrive account that's associated with your ID, this one up here. And I am going to be able to see here, I could open it in OneDrive. But what I wanted to quickly mention is that this is more of a convenience factor. Instead of having to separately open up OneDrive, it's just allowing me to quickly grab things that I need from it so that I can add them to a team to collaborate and share my work with others. I also have the option to connect to external non-Microsoft owned cloud storage accounts. As you can see here, I've connected my personal Dropbox, and I wanted to make a note that this is not able to be seen by anyone else but me. This is just, once again, a convenience factor so that I don't have to separately go and open up Dropbox. And these external cloud storage accounts, the ability to add them has to be turned on by your Office 365 administrator. However, other than your OneDrive cloud storage account, that administrator, he or she cannot actually see the content in it, because some of this is my personal stuff and I don't, to be honest, want anyone in my organization to see everything that's in regards to that. I've also got the option to connect to box.com, ShareFile, or Google Drive if I wanted to add even more external cloud storage accounts, just to save time from going to have to open them up separately, find files, download them, re-upload them, etc. So as I'm looking through here, ironically, I don't actually see a copy of the grant letter that I was hoping to find. So I'm thinking what I'm going to do is look in at the very top of my teams, we have what is called a unified search slash or at command experience. Now, I'll go into at and slash commands later in the demo, but right now all I'm going to do is just do a keyword search for the word grant, because I'm looking for anything to do with a grant letter that I might be able to reuse quickly. This is actually going to search all the teams that I have permission to, and it's going to bring me back results that are pertinent to the word grant. We have messages that were in channel conversations that have the word grant in them in the first search vertical. We also have a filter in case that there are too many options and we need to start to narrow them down by team or channel or who it was from or who mentioned them. We also could search any people. If I had someone named Grant in my organization, that would show up here. And we have files. Now I know it's a file. I know I want to filter it. Notice how the filter changed to be content specific to the search vertical that I'm currently in. I know that it is a Word document I'm looking for. I could filter. I should have narrowed results. And I'm going to bet money that the grant letter docx is what I'm probably looking for. So now this looks like a sample grant letter, and it looks like there's been some previous activity on it. So I am thinking this is probably the letter that I could reuse myself. Now, the first thing I want to make a note of, and you might have just seen me unbookmark that, is we went through a little bit of trouble to try and find a copy of this letter, and it's in a different team from the past. But I don't want to have to go through all of this centrifuge each time to find this letter, because it's all about saving time and getting things done more efficiently. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to come up and bookmark this letter. That way I can easily find things that have been that were important to me that I know I need to find later. And how I can go back to access them later is I will just go up and click on the icon of myself, and I'll go to my save tab, and that will bring back all of the things I've saved. You can unsave them and resave them as you need, so that you've just kind of got your list of your most commonly needed things that happen to be strewn across different teams available to you at any time. So I've got a grant letter sample. I wanted to show you on the right, we have a conversation going on around this team, so people can add their comments and thoughts about what they think that this letter should include. I happen to know that with grant letters, that A, when you're asking for money from somebody, you have to know how much money you need. You need to tell them exactly what you're going to use that money for, And last, it's usually not a full grant. It's only for part of the amounts that you're looking for. So now that I know these things, first thing that's going through my head is, I need to be able to figure out how much money we're going to ask for from these people for this grant. So I'm going to come back to our team, and I'm going to go over here into my general tab, general channel, and I'm going to go over to the little plus sign, and we're going to go into what are tabs. And with these tabs, sorry about that, folks, that was my alarm. And with a tab, and I'll explain the difference between tabs and connectors, we have the ability to add all of these external applications into our team. A tab is a window to another application. It is not reading or writing data back. It's just another convenience sake for you to not have to separately go and open these things. In this case, we've got the Microsoft ecosystem or stack of products at the top. Then we have tabs from a whole bunch of other pretty well-known brands such as Adobe, Hootsuite, Evernote, Power Apps, Trello, a lot of people use those as well. If you do not see the tabs at the bottom, it might be because you're either A, in a government tenant where they haven't been turned on, or B, it's because your administrator, unfortunately, is a party pooper and has turned them all off. But I'm an administrator myself, and I would say that maybe you don't want to have them all turned on. However, part of the power of Teams is allowing people to use these tabs and connectors. So I'd highly suggest at least enabling some of them. I'm going to go back to our project. I'm going to add a Power BI tab, which is Microsoft's data visualization tool. And I'm going to call this the SEAL rescue costs. I'm going to look for the particular area workspace that I had created this report in last week. I just happen to call it SEALs. I'm going to post to the channel about it. And as you can see, this tab is loading a Power BI interactive data visualization chart right inside the channel of my team. It still has the same behaviors it would as though I had opened up the Power BI client as a user. I still have the ability to zoom in, out, sort, filter, and do all the other wonderful things that I would have with a Power BI report. Now looking at this, I can quickly hover over my pie and realize that I'm going to need 1.875 million US for the majority of the SEALs I'll need to save. Another 112.5 US for a few of the SEALs that are caught around Australia. And for the ones that are even further out southeast, I'm going to need 9,000 per SEAL or 81,000 US total. So now I've got some totals here. I've got this report for everyone in my team to see. I can easily go back to my channel, or I'm sorry, to the bookmark that I'd made with my grant letter document. And I'm going to let everyone know that I've added this report with the amounts for the grant letter. Now, how I'm going to do that is I'm going to come back over to our ellipsis, which is the three dots next to the general channel. I'm going to click on it, and I'm going to get a link to this channel. I'm going to copy it. I'm going to go back to my saved bookmark of that template that we have for the grant letter. And I'm going to add to the conversation on the right side here. And I'm just going to paste this in here. Hey, everyone. I added a Power BI report with the cost of saving the baby SEALs in the general channel. Now, what I'm going to do is show you another one of my favorite shortcuts here. I'm selecting the Control K buttons on my keyboard, and that pops up a shortcut hyperlink. I'm going to type in the word here, and I'm going to paste in the address, because as you can see, this is a pretty long URL, and those will start to make our conversations look a bit disorganized and messy, and we don't want to do that. So I'm going to insert that here, and then I am going to call out Patty and ask her to please finish this letter. Please finish this letter for me and send off. I'm going to send this message. So let me get my go to team thing here, go to meeting out of the way. And now what has happened is, once again, Patty has been notified in her activity feed, which she can also filter by at mentions, and she'd be able to see that Matthew has just called her out and asked for a specific request in the team regarding the grant letter. I'm going to come back here to our SEAL rescue squad team that I've created, and I'm going to go into the general tab. Now, what I'm thinking is we're starting to run out of time, so I better really start to get going on the rest of this stuff. Now, with the fundraising, I know I had mentioned to everybody that you need that the grant letter is only going to get us part of the money we need. We need to figure out how we can raise some more money. So the next thing we're going to do is build a website, because every nonprofit needs a website, right? Nobody's going to, they want to know who you are, what you're about, what your mission is, and how much money you need to do and what you're doing with that money. So I've got a website channel here. I haven't added anything to it yet. However, I'd had some discussions already with some of the people that in my nonprofit here that I'm working with on how we were going to build this. And Chris, who is admittedly a lot more on top of things than I happen to be, has already gone into Azure DevOps, which was formerly known as Visual Studio Team Services, and created a website project plan in the Agile methodology for all of us. We just need to get the programmers on it so that we can finish having the website built. So the first thing that I'm going to do is, because I specifically remember that there was a task that we needed to get the code to build a fundraising thermometer so that people knew how close we were to matching our goal, I'm going to do what every master guru, senior computer programmer in the entire world does when they need to write some new code. I'm going to go to Google and I'm going to search for the code that somebody else has already written, and I'm going to borrow it. So I'm going to just search for a fundraising thermometer code here. I'm going to get the first result that happens to come back, and lo and behold, what do you see? We see an example fundraising thermometer that someone has so graciously already given us the code to easily copy. Now, this is great, but the problem is if I was to paste this into a regular instant message or a email or a chat conversation normally, that it would get discombobulated or misconstrued about how the computer would, you know, the ASCII text would convert it to format. It might not be easy for my programmers to be able to copy back into the HTML page to code. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to come down here and I'm going to click on the format icon that's below my channel conversation box. And as you can see now, what has happened is our channel conversation box has turned into a full rich text editor. It has a subject line, which I highly suggest that you use, because by doing so, we're starting an initial topic and then everyone's replying to it in a very neatly organized conversation thread. And I'm going to add a subject called a fundraising thermometer code. I am then going to come over here. I could make highlights, change the font size, add bullets and or links and such. But in this case, I'm going to click on our code snippet icon, because this is one of my favorite little features in Teams. I can click on the code snippet icon. I can pick which programming language I'm using, which in this case happens to be HTML. And I can paste that code that I just borrowed from that website right here and insert it into this channel conversation I'm about to have. I am going to let Chris know that I found this code for the website. Please put it to good use. I can call Chris out. He'll get notified. He's going to receive this message with the thermometer, and I can send this off to him. And what will end up happening is, once again, when he gets that and he acknowledges it, he's just going to click his thumbs up symbol, and then I'm going to know that he has received my channel conversation and he's going to be working on that code. Now, another cool thing I wanted to go into, because we haven't touched on them yet and happens to be related to agile website development, is connectors. If we come over to the left side of our Microsoft Teams client, we see another ellipsis, and these are where our apps and connectors are. Now, there's a few that might be previously used by you, or they might be suggestions for Microsoft. However, there's actually a full ecosystem in the Microsoft Store here for Teams of all sorts of different connectors, some from Microsoft and some from third-party systems. Some of them are very well-known, big companies, Jira, Adobe. Some of them are smaller and unique. Once again, these are up to your Office 365 tenant administrator to turn on or not, but hopefully they are somebody who understands the importance of having these in your team or the ability to use them, and they will not turn them all off for you. So I'm going to search for Azure DevOps, because as I mentioned, Chris had earlier created a Agile project for us to build the website already in this. Once again, that used to be Visual Studio Team Services. It's now Azure DevOps. And all I'd have to do is add it and click on some connections to get it going. I'm not going to go through the entire process of configuring it because it takes a couple minutes, and I've already got it connected to another team separately. But what I wanted to show you is the importance of or the convenience of having this connected. I'm going to come into a previously created team. We're just going to pretend for the moment that this happens to be the same team that we're working in. And what I wanted to let you see is as we come over here to Azure DevOps, I've got my Agile project created. We've got this project in here for the SEAL Rescue Squad. It's already been broken out into epics and task items and sprints. And I'm going to show you how when I come in here to update a task and save it, that because we have a live connection to Azure DevOps inside our team, that we are going to get a notification that I have just closed out that task. And there you go. See, folks, change state to close. That was pretty awesome, huh? And I don't have to go separately checking in Visual Studio or, sorry, Azure DevOps all day long to see what the status of this website project is at the moment. I could also directly link to them via these buttons on the card that's popped up in the channel conversation. But I just think that this is another great feature of how I can keep all of my tasks in line and save a whole bunch of time and frustration by just using my Microsoft Teams application. All right, so now we've knocked out two of our four things. We have a little bit of time left, so I'm going to quickly go into the street fundraising. I have, this is a pretty simple task I have to do. All I need to do is get a template here for people that are going to volunteer and go out and hit the streets in some of the cities in Europe and the US, and they're going to help raise money and get people interested in our cause. So what I know I need to do first is I need to check the weather in some of the cities that people are going to be out in to make sure that it is okay for people to go out and they won't be freezing or in the rain all day long. Now, because I've already have a connection to Bing, I can pull in news, stock market quotes, some internet research, and the at weather at command, which is going to pull from Bing service. And I can check the weather in London today. It's going to pop up, and I can see it looks like it's really quite a brilliant day in London, as they say over there. And so that's one weather. I'm going to just pop that in here. Oh, sorry. Let me try that one more time. Maybe a please compose extension. Might have made a little boo-boo there. Weather. I'm going to type in London again. Should pop up. There we go. Send it off. Let everybody know that London's good. And then one of my other cities, I know that we're going to have some people hitting the streets in. Another one of my favorite cities in Europe, Amsterdam. And, there we go. I'm starting to think I couldn't remember how to spell Amsterdam. I was getting a bit concerned. Let's see here. Well, maybe we're having a little bit of problem with the connection with that. So I'm just going to put in my message to everyone. Hey, everyone, I have checked the weather for our cities, and it is all good. We can hit the streets to raise money today. So normally I don't have that problem, but I will be honest with you. Sometimes there are little hiccups with all these separate connections that are running in and out of Teams to other products. The last thing I needed to do is just get everybody a copy of the form that the people will be asking money from to fill out, as they'll have on their clipboards. I'm going to come back in here to my files tab. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to look for a copy of the, in my OneDrive account, I know I've got a copy of this file for street fundraising, and I'm going to use the ellipsis to just copy that file into the channel directly. This is another quick shortcut or feature to be able to move things fast into our channels. I'm going to pick the SEAL Rescue Squad, I'm going to pick street fundraising, and I'm going to click copy. And then I'm going to go back to our team, and it has copied it into the files tab magically for everyone. And they will be able to see the form they need to fill out for the street fundraising. Now, the last thing that I want to get done for our project is I need to get some marketing done. Because as I mentioned, everybody's got a nonprofit, everyone's got a cause, everybody's got a website, but not everybody knows about everybody's missions in life. So I'm going to come up here to our search, like I said, unified at command box, search box, and slash command box. And we haven't touched on slash commands yet. These are pre-built quick programmed commands, kind of like Excel macros that automatically do things for you. As you can see, we have the ones that have come over from Skype for Business or Skype for Business Online, such as your status. You could set to do not disturb, which is what I've done, and that's why I've got a red icon here. I could change it to available, be right back, all those things. I could call somebody, I can get the latest help, I could see all of my at mentions, but my another great one I like to use is slash go to, because if I have a bunch of teams and I've got a bunch of channels and I don't want to have to sort too much on the left hand side of my team's client, I can just quickly type in the name of the channel and it'll start to pop up and it will automatically bring me to the ones I'm looking for. In this case, I actually need to go to the marketing channel because that is where I'm going to do the last part of this. And I'm wondering if I have too many because I'm not seeing it here. It's bringing me to a different one, but that's okay. I've created a few of these sample teams over here, so that might be why that's doing that. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to add a connector because everybody needs to promote their website and their missions on social media. And I am going to add a connector for everyone's favorite form of communication these days, Twitter. Now, once again, I'm going to hope the demo gods are with me because I'm doing this all live. And sometimes there's a short delay with these things, but I'm going to actually attempt to install the Twitter connector in my channel. I'm going to follow the Microsoft Teams handle because I know that there's activity on that happens pretty frequently. And then I'm also going to type our hashtag of our mission for the SEAL Rescue Squad that we'll be using in all of our social media promotions. And I'm going to ask to include everything, any types of tweets, retweets, mentions. I'm going to ask for this to be delivered immediately. I should get a confirmation back letting me know in the channel that this has been properly configured. And then this is the part where the demo gods have to play their role. I need to see how quickly any tweets with our hashtags or the handle of Microsoft Teams that we're following might show up in our channel here. So I'm going to give that just a second while we're waiting for it. And hope it will come. But as I am going to make sure that I let our marketing manager, Margie, know that I have started a social media campaign. Now, one thing about this is I actually forgot Margie's last name. So I kind of need to figure out where Margie is in the organization. and or what her last name is so that I can call her out. And this is going to bring me to another one of my favorite slash commands, which is the Who bot. I can click on Who, and I don't remember Margie's last name, but I do remember that she worked with my co-author, Melissa. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to click Who, and I'm going to see that what will happen is it's going to show me Melissa in my organization, and then I can also come down here and see who she works with. Now, that's going to go back. It's going to bring me more results, and I see that she's worked with somebody named Margie Marketing Manager. I can come back to my team. I can come back to the marketing tab, and I can, oh, wow, what do you know? See, it don't less than a minute, folks. Look at all these tweets it pulled in. That is pretty awesome. So here we go. These are all from the Microsoft Teams handle. This connector did work, and the demo gods were with me today. Yes, thank you so much. I can let Margie know that I will. I'm going to start this campaign. I can do that at the end. But since we're starting to run out of time here, I just have one last task before we do a quick recap, and we can get to some questions and answers that you might have from today's presentation. I'm going to come back over here, and I am going to send Hugh a message to let him know that I have finished all of our tasks that he has assigned to me today with everything you gave me. And then I am going to add a sticker. The difference between a sticker and an animated GIF is I could actually change the words in it if I wanted to. In this case, I don't need to. I feel confident in letting Hugh know that, oh yeah, I've got everything done, and he can wait until tomorrow to get mad at me for something else. I can come back into my team, and I could also, if I wanted to, let everyone know that thanks everyone for their help today. You are awesome. I could quickly add another sticker here for awesome. Add that in. I like to have fun in my team and make people smile. Hopefully I've made you smile a little bit today. We can quickly recap over here in my team everything we've learned today, and then we can get to some questions and answers. Here we go. Just go into the here, into my PowerPoint, which you can also add directly into a team. These are all the things that we recapped in today's session. As far as what we've learned, we have learned about what teams, then the main components are, teams, channels, tabs, how to schedule meetings, how to have funny conversations with GIFs and stickers, held conversations around documents and other artifacts, use the search at slash command box, added connectors, and most importantly, we brought people together to work towards a common goal in completing the tasks for our nonprofit to save the baby seals. So I'm going to leave it on my contact tab, and I'm going to give the microphone back to Shane to let me know if he's got any questions that have been asked that I could answer for everyone.
Thanks for a great presentation, Matthew. Yeah, we will start the questions and answers part now. And should you have any questions for Matthew, feel free to type them into the questions window. First question, Matthew, I have seen some differences between my team client and the web interface at times. Do you have any idea why this is?
Yes. So the thing with the downloadable client and the web interface is that they do not update at the exact same time. So because you can also, Teams is available in three different ways at the moment. It's available via an internet browser, via a mobile phone client, or via a downloadable client onto your computer. You could also get to it by logging in here at teams.microsoft.com. However, you will sometimes see things updated faster in the web client than you will in the download client, because the sync is running with them differently. If you ever ran into a problem where you were not seeing things after an hour or two or overnight in your client, I would suggest going to my blog and checking out the article on how to clear the cache in your client, and that should hopefully fix the problem.
Great. How do you differentiate between using Microsoft Teams or Office 365 groups? Is there recommended scenarios for both?
So it kind of there is a feature difference. Office 365 groups are built in Outlook. You would create one over here in your group section, and where is that? There they are. I would create a new group, but they are basically limited to things just such as emails going back and forth, conversations, a SharePoint site, and a notebook. They do not have any of the connectors, tabs, funny GIFs and GIFs, the Skype for Business calling, video calling, and conferencing features. So I like to call groups a nice basic way to collaborate with people, but I like to call Teams the ultimate way to collaborate with people.
Very good. Can you recover a team when it is deleted? Or can you archive a team?
Funny you mentioned that because Microsoft just added this feature a couple of months ago, actually, where you can go onto your little cog or gear icon down here and you can actually archive your teams. You can see I have some archived. You would just come over here and archive the team. It would fall from the top to the bottom, and then you can manage them here. If you delete a team, it will go into the tenant's recycle bin for 30 days, and that is only something that your Office 365 administrator would be able to recover if you had actually physically deleted it.
Okay. Is there a way of integrating Teams with SharePoint tasks?
Oh boy. At this time, I don't know of a way unless I will say there were some new updates to the SharePoint framework last Friday. I believe it's version 1.7. If you wanted to do custom programming, you might be able to create something that would create cards that would go back and forth. But my first example for you on that, if you wanted to do it, would actually just open up the page of your SharePoint task list, and then I would come into my tab. I would click website. And I would paste the URL, I would call the SharePoint tasks, and then I'd paste the URL to it here, and it would become a tab surfaced inside of my team so that you don't have to keep opening up the SharePoint website separately. They can just update and manage their tasks directly inside the team here.
Okay, super. Can you save the video discussion or record yourself and post it as a message?
Well, you can definitely record meetings, and I wonder if you're saying like, could I just turn on my webcam, record it, and post it?
Yeah, the question is, can you save the live video discussion? So if I'm assuming that if there was like a meeting, can you record it?
So yes, you can. So one of the many components of Microsoft Teams, because there's a lot, and I wanted to quickly just say, because I hear this a lot frequently, people keep going, isn't Teams just SharePoint? Isn't Teams just SharePoint? Teams is actually Skype for Business Consumer, Skype for Business Online, SharePoint, Exchange, Azure, Cosmos DB, an open source framework called Electron, and a whole bunch more. So no, Teams is not just SharePoint. It's a lot of things. And another component of it is Stream, which is Microsoft's streaming video service available in Office 365. And as long as your administrator has enabled recording of meetings, yes, you can record them, and they'll be available via Stream. And then you could either add them as a tab or just link to them directly by pasting a hyperlink.
Okay, bear with me on this one. It's a long one. Can we add a page from a SharePoint site, root, or a subsite displaying a custom web part in the team site? Also, please suggest on the customization possible via REST APIs to draw data from Teams to SharePoint site or vice versa.
I'm wondering if one of my friends is getting on here to give me difficult questions and try to stump me. So the first part of that question I can answer in the sense of you could add a SharePoint page if it's a modern SharePoint page that's been built on the SharePoint framework, and you could actually cr at the same release that came out last Friday, version 1.7. I saw that you now have the ability to create custom modern web parts and embed them directly as a page inside of your team. I think that your classic SharePoint pages that have web parts, you could add as a website URL, but I don't know how well that they'll look on mobile or responsive different size devices. The other part with the REST API, I know that with the Microsoft Graph, there are a lot of commands. If you go to graph.microsoft.com, there's the different ways to administer and program, get information or command things in Teams from a programmatic standpoint is to use PowerShell or the Graph. There are more Microsoft Graph commands and properties available for Teams and groups right now than there are for PowerShell. So I would suggest going to graph.microsoft.com and going into the beta reference for Teams to see all of the options and instructions on how to do that.
Okay. The questions are streaming in, Matthew, so I might just have to wrap them up after one or two more, and then the people will have to contact you directly. Is that okay?
Yeah. I once again put back up my contact information. I'm just being honest with you folks. Teams is a hot topic, and we get a little bit too many questions usually. Go ahead, Dave.
Okay. So the last three questions. How do SharePoint tabs work? Can you associate a SharePoint site or libraries with a team or channel?
Yes, you can. Once again, with a tab here, you just add, come up, click a tab, and you can add either a SharePoint article or page directly, or you could add a SharePoint document library. I'm trying to think of, once again, if this doesn't go to exactly to the page or list you're wanting, I'd refer back to that website tab. One other thing is if you've created a modern SharePoint site, you might have noticed now in the bottom left corner that there's a link that says, hey, create a team to go with your new modern SharePoint site. So in that sense, you'd be actually creating a SharePoint site based on a group that is also, you could create a team based on the same group. So that would be a way to associate them.
Okay. Do you know when we would be able to set different permissions for different channels?
Oh, wow. Okay, the number one most requested feature and hottest topic of everything about Microsoft Teams for the past year. I have no official confirmation from Microsoft. However, I did see something on Twitter, and since it was posted on Twitter, and that means it's already become a rumor, that it is something that's in testing, but I don't have any confirmation on the status of it, and Microsoft hasn't made an official announcement, but I strongly believe that it's going to come because their main competitor has that feature, and I know Microsoft knows how important it is that they deliver it. So check the User Voice website for updates on that, folks.
Okay, great. Last question. Does Teams offer assistance such as narration for visually impaired individuals?
Just ask, some of these questions almost seemed like they were perfectly tailored or written for me to answer them. Why, yes. if we come into some of these things, some of the channel conversations, we have what's called an immersive reader. If you click on the immersive reader, what do you see? You see voice transcription, different text size preferences for people who might have a harder time seeing the screen, and a couple other features that are available for visually or hearing impaired persons.
That's super. And finally, just so you know, it is a nice day in London.
Well, believe me when I say I wish I was there because I'd be shopping at Harrods right now.
Oh, very good. Very good. Next time you're there, you can pick us up some of their famous biscuits or something like that. Matthew, thank you so much for taking the time to join us today. Very much appreciate on behalf of the European SharePoint Office 365 and Azure community.
Yeah, well, thank you for having me, and thanks, everybody. Bye.
That's brilliant, Matthew. Thank you so much again. Okay, let's just get things wrapped up here, everybody. That is all for today. See sharepointeurope.com/register-for-webinars for further details on all upcoming webinars, or visit our resource center for all previous webinars. And this webinar will be added to the resource center later today, where you will be notified by email when it is available. Thank you once again to our webinar presenter, Matthew Bailey, and thank you all for joining us. Hopefully we will see you soon in Copenhagen. Take care and goodbye.